Coming to you live from the shadow of the big house, it's IT for You. Tips and tricks on ITS tools, products, services, and more with your host, Gene Mackey. Welcome to IT for You. I'm your host, Gene Mackey. This is a monthly series of webinars brought to you by Information and Technology Services, or ITS. We offer demos and tips of ITS products, tools, services, and more. So if you're a person with a disability who needs an accommodation in order to participate, please let us know. If it's for a live webinar, we need 10 days notice. So today we've got universal access tips for Mac OS X with Jane Vincent.
Hi, I'm Jane Vincent. I'm the Assistive Technology Lead for the University of Michigan. And I'm here today to talk about universal access tips for Macintosh OS X. If you've seen the presentation about ease of access tips for Windows, some of the features that we're going to be talking about here that can benefit people with, and for that matter, without disabilities, are going to be very similar. The Macintosh has a smaller feature set than Windows does, but it does have some features that are unique to the Mac that Windows does not have. So I'm going to start by talking about the Universal Access Control Panel. And the first item, we'll look at that control panel in just a moment, but the first item on that control panel is a screen reader called VoiceOver. On the Windows side, you do need to at least install a screen reader. With the Macintosh, a screen reader comes built in. So to give you a little idea of how VoiceOver works, I can use the arrow keys on the VoiceOver window to move up and down.
Verbosity, speech, navigation.
And it's going to speak what I'm doing. I also have the option of being able to show the text. So for people with some vision who are just getting used to the computer voice, having the simultaneous audio and visual may be very useful. In addition, for some people with learning disabilities, the simultaneous audio and visual may be very useful. So what I'm going to do is to go into the speech options.
Speech.
Use the right arrow key to, use the tab
voices.
Key.
Select a tab. Mute speech.
To unchecked move around checkbox. These options.
Bruce, default voice pop-up button.
And without using the mouse at all, because blind individuals are not able to use a mouse, I
you
can use the arrow
the
keys
nine items check mark. Bruce, Alex.
To Mid, choose
Victoria.
A different voice.
Vicky.
I'm going to choose Vicky. I can then hit return.
Vicky, the best way to predict the future is to invent it. Closing menu, utility category. You are
and
currently
then
on a table. To add default, rate 50, content selected, default, pitch, edit text.
I can continue to use the tab key, the shift tab, to move backwards through options.
Table. To enter this table, press control, option, shift, down arrow.
And to use the arrow keys to move around and set my preferences. So I'm going to go ahead and close
entering,
VoiceOver.
Entering VoiceOver, entering system.
And I happen to use the mouse to do that, but I wouldn't need to. And what we're seeing here is Universal Access Seeing Panel. Now the next option on this panel is Zoom. If I turn the Zoom functionality on, should come on. So it's giving me the option of having a small window, just like a magnifying glass, or I can zoom the entire screen. Now, notice that this is somewhat blurry. We are going to be looking at another zoom option a little later in the presentation that tends to be much clearer. But this is a fairly flexible option if somebody needs either the entire screen or a portion of the screen at a time magnified. This does provide at least some magnification capability. Okay. For some people, it's easier to see white text on a black background, so I can modify the display so that it's white on black. Unfortunately, it inverts all the colors, which looks rather unpleasant. So if I prefer, I can leave it at black and white and instead use grayscale, and that gives me a very nice black on white or white on black. without having some of the uglier colors if I'm doing just the white on black inversion. I can also modify the contrast, so if I need the contrast to be sharpened, I do have a scroll bar that will let me adjust that to my particular preferences. The next option under Universal Access is Hearing. I'm actually going to go back to Seeing and set it back to a standard contrast. Under Hearing, I have two very nice features. One is a feature that flashes the screen when an alert sound occurs. Very often in a computer operating system, it will beep to let you know that there's a problem. But if somebody is deaf or hard of hearing, they may not be able to hear that beep. They may not know what's going on. So I can have a redundant screen flash. I can click on the test the screen flash, and it flashes the screen for me. And that way, if I'm getting a system beep, I have a redundant visual that lets me know what's going on. I also have the option for somebody who's hard of hearing, and is only using a microphone in one ear. They may have a hearing aid in the other ear. If they're only using one ear for their headphone, they're not going to be able to hear stereo sound. So I do have a setting that lets me play stereo audio as mono, and that way all the sound is going through the single headphone and the individual will not miss any auditory information. The next option that I have is the keyboard under Universal Access, and this has two very useful utilities. One is Sticky Keys, and what Sticky Keys does is, if you've ever had to type using fewer than 10 fingers, for example, as happened to me once, if you have your arm in a sling or in a cast, it's very difficult to hold down multiple keys at a time for multi-key combination. So what Sticky Keys lets you do is to press keys in sequence. So for example, if I wanted to press Shift F to get a capital letter, or I wanted to press Command Q or Cloverleaf Q to close a window, if I had Sticky Keys on, it would let me press those keys in sequence. So I could press the Shift key, release it, press the letter key at my leisure, because Sticky Keys is not time dependent, and it would function exactly as if I'd held two or more keys down at the same time. What Slow Keys does is, for people who have tremors or people who have other issues with their dexterity, it may be difficult to pull your hand away from the keyboard quickly enough to avoid key repeats. So what Slow Keys does is it slows down that key repeat, or it turns it off altogether. So for example, if I had it turned off and I wanted to type the word hello, I would physically have to take my hand off the L key and repress the key to get that second L. So again, for people with Parkinson's, with cerebral palsy, Slow Keys can be very, very useful. I can also adjust how long I have to hold down the key until the key repeat is accepted. The fourth item on Universal Access has to do with the mouse and trackpad. And the main utility here is called Mouse Keys. What Mouse Keys lets me do is to use the keypad that's available on most desktop machines, or an external keypad, as my mouse. So except for the 5 and 0, all the number keys would be keys for moving the pointer. The 5 key would emulate a mouse click, and the 0 key would initiate a drag. So I could move my pointer over an object, hit the 0 key, hit any of the number keys except 5, the item would then move in whatever direction I wanted. When, say, I got the item over the trash can or where I wanted it to be, I would simply hit the 5 key or the escape key, and that would function exactly as if I'd done a drag using the mouse. Another very nice feature that's on the mouse control panel is the ability to modify the cursor size. So what I can do with this scroll bar is, as I move it over to the right, the cursor gets larger until it gets quite large indeed, or as I move it back, the cursor gets smaller again. So for some people with low vision, the issue is not necessarily so much seeing text as it is being able to visually track the cursor or the pointer, and what this does is gives me a larger target to see. So those are the items in the Universal Access Control Panel, which is very much focused on accessibility. But there are a number of other features built into the Macintosh Control Panel that can enhance accessibility as well. And the next one of those that I'd like to talk about is the Displays Control Panel. And if I go into Displays, which is in the hardware set, I can modify the resolutions. So for example, if I want to go to a display mode that's 800 by 600, you're going to see that the text has become quite a bit bigger. I'm not able to see, and that the screen has become condensed. I can also modify the brightness so that if the standard screen display is too dark for me to see or it's too light for my visual ability or my comfort level, it's very easy for me to modify the brightness until, in an extreme case, until I'm not able to see anything. But that's a very nice feature, again, for people with low vision who may have certain preferences that make it easier to see the screen. These are built in to any OS X Macintosh. This is where I can modify the resolution. If I want to modify the screen color and appearance, I would go to the General Control Panel. And here what I can do is to change the appearance to either blue or graphite. I can also change, being a little slow on me, I can also change the highlight color. So if it's easier with the graphite appearance for me to, say, have red as the highlight color, that's very easy to change. That affects the overall look of buttons, menus, and windows. For the highlight color, that affects the selected text. The General Control Panel also lets me affect how scroll bars are shown. I can have scroll bars shown automatically based on the input device, or only shown when I'm scrolling, or always shown. I can modify what the scroll bar does. I can modify how many recent items are shown. So if someone would get overloaded by having too many items in the recent item list, I can modify that to be a smaller number. I also have an option to have LCD font smoothing kick in when available. So even on the General Control Panel, there are a number of options that can be very useful. So, going on to my next page, on the Keyboard Control Panel, if I click on Keyboard, again, I can modify the key repeat and the delay until repeat. So if I don't want to do that through the Universal Access, I can do that through the Keyboard Control Panel instead. I can also specify that F1 and F2, etc., are used as standard function keys, which might be useful, for example, if a third-party piece of assistive technology is dependent on having those standard function keys be in place. I can also automatically illuminate the keyboard in low light, so for somebody with low vision who benefits from having the keyboard illuminated, that can be done automatically in response to the environment. Keyboard shortcuts can also be modified. Keyboard shortcuts can be very useful for people who cannot or have difficulty using a mouse. So I can go in under the Keyboard Shortcuts feature, under the Keyboard Control Panel, and modify how the shortcuts are used. For example, if there's a standard keyboard shortcuts that's conflicting with a shortcut in an application program that I'm using, it's very easy to go in and change that. So the last control panel that I want to show you is the mouse control panel. And there are a number of very nice things here. I can control the tracking speed. So if it's difficult for me to see the standard speed of the mouse movement, I can slow that down, or if I want the tracking speed to be faster, I can modify that. I can modify the scrolling speed. I can modify the double click speed for some people who have difficulty with double clicking. It's very easy to slow down the speed so that I have a greater window between the first click and the second click. For some people, that's going to make a huge difference. For people who are left-handed, they may want to have the primary mouse button be on the right. If you have a two-button mouse, that's very easy to set through the mouse control panel. And then, as a final nice thing, I promised you a better magnification strategy. What you can do here is set things up so that you can zoom using the scroll window while holding down the control key, or you can modify that to be another key. And notice here, this gives you, on this computer actually, it's giving you about the same quality of magnification, but that's a very easy way to change the magnification level on the fly. So Jean is going to be showing you a slide with some information about additional resources and my contact information. I welcome any questions, and I thank you for attending our presentation today.
Okay, thank you very much, Jane, for providing this information. Jane did give us some links to resources, and if you search on IT4U04 in MyLink, you'll bring up a document that has all of these links live. Reminder that the recording of this session is available in MyLink on the IT4U webpage. You can also sign up for announcements of upcoming episodes, and if you need any additional help, you can contact the ITS Service Center. Thank you very much for today, and glad you could join us.